Hi, this is Squints, and this is my American dream. Knowing that anything is possible at any time, and really believing that if you want to do something, then you can accomplish it. I made tonight a memory.
I can walk the miles and miles. In the summer of 2012, I came in contact with a childhood celebrity. Many may recognize him from his past films, Casper, Father of the Bride, but most important, The Sandlot. But Chauncey Leopardi, known as Squints to some, has a unique story. In this film, we go behind the plastic frames.
I don't know, a lot of people say that there's things that hold us back. And granted, Bill Gates wouldn't have been Bill Gates if he wasn't had access to computer programming at such a young age. You know, different things have to happen for certain events to arise, to people to become the people that they are. But at the same time, I think if somebody really wants something and they really are willing to work for it, I don't think that there's anything that we can't create. The American dream is our thoughts becoming reality, right? And whatever we think of, we can make. Amen. That morning sky gave me a look. So I left while you were sleeping. That's all it took.
Really when I got there, I didn't know his role was going to be as big as it turned out to be. And, you're proud. It's a really neat experience, to watch it all transpire. And we were talking about the other day, getting to see the dailies where they don't, going to see them and what they shot that day and stuff. It's really neat. They're again very proud. It's a tough business, very tough. I don't know that a lot of people understand how tough it is. And transforming from one age to another age and, moving on with it. And just, getting burned out by it too, I think. Mm-hmm. We talked about that quite a bit. When you start doing something at a real young age, and like the auditions, and like I said, people don't understand the drag and, how much work it actually is. They think it's just popping easy, and it's not. It's really a lot of work, so that, that's always kind of caught me.
Yeah.
I swim here every summer in my adult life. Every summer, there she is. Oh, oily. Oily. Oh,
and one day, it became too much for Michael Squints Polidorus. And he did the most desperate thing any of us had ever seen.
I mean, I thought it was cool, but it was never, like I said, I wasn't your typical actor. I've always been a very fortunate person. So it's hard to explain, but things kind of just happened for me. It was more of, I enjoyed it. And, like my dad said before, it's a tough process sometimes. So as a young kid, I think I probably threatened to quit like every other day, more or less, because I'm just, at times it can be a little tiring. You're driving around LA in a car for 5 hours a day after you go to school, trying to go from audition to audition, changing in the car, and it can be a little frustrating at times when you have, kids want to be kids. But I always enjoyed it. It's fun to work. I've never been a big auditioner. I didn't really enjoy that as much. It was a little kind of lame and tiring. But I would say that I do consider myself an actor, and I've been trained in more or less every format you can outside of stage, you know, from sketch comedy to script analysis to method acting, and all at a very young age. I was taking method acting courses as a kid, and I mean, realistically, you're not even supposed to teach children method because it's they're not able to control their emotions at a young age, and they don't really have the life experiences that it takes to use the method anyway. But I was pretty just natural at it, you know. I kind of would shock my teachers and the people I worked with, and I honestly probably tried about half as hard as everybody else did, you know. Where some people were, you know, this is their main focus, I was just kind of like, this is something that I do, you know. Honda, the guy, I forget his first name, but his last name is Honda. He started out making, working on engines in his backyard, basically. And he pawned all his wife's rings and jewelry to try to get his start. And he couldn't get the big contracts in Japan because Toyota Corporation was the major corporation before the war. And then when the war happened, he built these little, there was a gas shortage, so they didn't have gas for cars, really. And he built these little he put a lawnmower motor on a bicycle, and he built like the first little, he built little mopeds, basically. And that was a big deal, and he started selling those one by one, but he still couldn't get the big government contracts. Well, I guess the Americans during the war, when they were over there in Japan, they would just throw these big old steel gas tanks. And during wartime in Japan, it was very impossible to get any kind of metal like that. Steel and aluminum and all that stuff was very scarce because of the war. So he would collect these gas cans that the Americans would use them, and then they would just dump them. So he built Honda off of dumped American gas cans from American vehicles. And that was the big thing. Wow, it's nice.
If I sing but don't have love, I waste my breath with every song I bring. An empty voice, a hollow voice.
You know, a lot of my buddies, when we go out, they like to brag about it a little bit. And also, it's, you know, when people do, and I see them freak out and smile and say no way, and yeah, they get excited about it, and that's really what makes me happy about it, is that they can, you know, it's funny how somebody can go from, you know, just calm and collect and not really care to freaking out and excited you know, like you completely change their day.
I play baseball myself.
Do you? What position do you play?
I do third base.
Yeah?
And pitcher.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I played center field in the movie, but, you know, I've been all around the thing. You got a good fastball?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You right-handed, left-handed?
Right-handed.
Okay. Yeah. We went out to interview this guy named Carlos. He was a pizza delivery man, Cuban immigrant from South Florida. And one day his boss came to him and said, Carlos, you have a truck. I want you to go deliver this couch to one of my customers. Do you think you could do that for me? And Carlos said, yeah, no problem, man. I'll do it, you know? So he takes this couch to this guy, and it ends up being Rupert Everett, the actor, right? So he delivers the couch, and Rupert's like, I really like you, man. You're a good guy. I have this friend that's moving next week, and I was wondering if you could put a little crew together and move her, you know? We'll pay you good. It'll be a good job. And he was like, yeah, sure, why not, you know? So
that's the positiveness in his nature that progresses the story. So the friend that Rupert Everett was talking about moving was Madonna. So this guy went from pizza delivery man to moving Madonna within a couple weeks' time. And then from Madonna, he started doing J-Lo's and this and that through the network of celebrities. He became known as like the celebrity mover guy. And through moving celebrities and big multi-million dollar mansions on Star Island and all around South Beach and South Florida, he became an expert in like delivering and shipping and storing like high-end fine art. And he became like the go-to guy around the country to deliver. Like, he does jobs from like 5,000 to half a million to move somebody, basically. And he would store these pieces, and sometimes people wouldn't come to pick them up, and he would go through all the legalities of basically obtaining this fine art. So now he has this warehouse filled with like $30 or $40 million worth of fine art. This is a guy that was a pizza delivery man not 10 years ago, and now he has this art collection, knows nothing about art really, but it's just a pretty cool and a really interesting story. That's the American dream, I guess. So.
I think just, you know, live your life, man, and follow your heart. And if it tells you you need to be in a certain place doing a certain thing, then do that, you know? Don't let the nuances of life get you down and kind of push you into a corner or make you feel like you need to take something less than you think you deserve just because you got something that needs to get done. I know it's hard for people to understand sometimes when I say that, you know, they got bills and they can't really, you know, chase dreams, but chasing dreams is what it's all about, right? I mean, at the end of the day, if good or bad, you can sit down when you're an old man and say that you have no regrets, and I think you had a pretty good life. It's more about the experience than the monetary value, so just try to smile, man. Have a good time.
Takes the heart rate.